first question as we have Brother Cogley read the lesson tonight.
And for celebrating the Passover in the spring of 30 CE, Jesus and his disciples leave Jerusalem. However, they do not directly return to their homes in Galilee. They go into the country of Judea, where they baptize many. John the Baptist has been doing a similar work for about a year, and some of his disciples are still with him, perhaps in the Jordan River Valley. Jesus himself does not baptize anyone. His disciples do so under his direction. At this point in Jesus' ministry, both Jesus and John are teaching Jews who are repentant over their sins against God's law covenant. John's disciples are jealous, complaining to him about Jesus. The man Jesus who was with you is baptizing, all are going to him. Yet John is not jealous. He rejoices in Jesus' success and wants his disciples to rejoice too. John reminds them, "You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I'm not the Christ, but I've been sent ahead of that one." He illustrates this point in a way that all can understand. Whoever has the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom, when he stands and hears him, has a great deal of joy on account of the voice of the bridegroom. So my joy has been made complete. John, like the friend of the bridegroom, rejoiced months earlier upon introducing his disciples to Jesus. Some of them followed Jesus and would in time be anointed with Holy Spirit. John also wants his present disciples to follow Jesus. In fact, John's purpose is to prepare the way for Christ's ministry. John explains, that one must keep on increasing, but I must keep on decreasing. A different John, who had earlier begun to follow Jesus, later writes concerning Jesus' origin and key role in human salvation, the one who comes from above is over all others. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. The one who exercises faith in the Son has everlasting life. The one who disobeys the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God remains upon him. What an important truth for people to know. Not long after John the Baptist discusses that his role and work must decrease, he's arrested by King Herod. Herod has taken Herodias, the wife of his half-brother Philip, and married her. When John publicly exposes his adulterous deed, Herod has him put in prison. Upon hearing about John being arrested, Jesus leaves Judea with his disciples and withdraws into Galilee.
Thank you, Brother Cogley. The first question, what is the meaning of the baptism done by John? Sister Martinez?
Acts 19, verse 4 comes up that Paul said, John baptizes with the baptism in symbol of repentance, telling all the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is, in Jesus. So he was actually preparing the way for Jesus.
Okay, very good. A little more on that? Brother Davey in this sound booth.
This is after the Passover, and it brings out that they didn't go back to Galilee right away. They stayed in the country of Judea, which is just north there of Jerusalem. And they were doing baptism too. But this was not the Christian baptism that was going to be later on. This was still the same type of baptism that John was doing, that Jesus was doing.
And what else? Did Jesus confirm what John was doing? It brought out in the, not the reasoning book, come on, Hank. The Insight Book, Volume 1 under Baptism. Jesus confirmed that John's ministry and baptism were from God. So Jesus went along with what John was doing. And there's quite a bit more. John came preaching baptism in symbol of repentance for forgiveness of sins. Baptism conditioned on repentance. So let's ask the next part of that question. What meaning is the baptism done under Jesus' direction prior to his resurrection? Brother Cogley?
Much like Brother Davey mentioned, he was doing the same type of baptism, repenting of their sins against the law, showing people that they could not live up to the law. And eventually it would be shown that when he founded the Christian congregation that he was the answer to that. But basically at the beginning, their two baptisms were for the same purpose.
Okay. Was there any differences in the baptisms? Brother Solano, please.
The paragraph helps us to appreciate that at this particular point, which is a year after John started baptizing, where Jesus and his disciples come into the picture. It tells us that both Jesus and John are teaching Jews who are repentant. So evidently these ones were already repentant over their sins, but now they needed further instruction. So this is where Jesus and his disciples come in to make disciples.
Okay. Brother Cogley?
I appreciated the point, too, that Jesus himself wasn't doing baptizing. He was teaching his disciples to continue what he was doing, and he let them do the baptism under his direction.
Very good.
John did the baptizing himself.
Yeah, very good. That was my next question. So thank you. And let's see, there was a little more. Anybody else? Okay, it brought out, sacrificing an offering you did not want, but you prepared a body for me. Look, I am come in the role of a book to do what? Did Jesus say? Almost gave it away.
To do Jehovah's will. And so, that's where you sit. We get baptized today for that same purpose, is to do Jehovah's will.
Very good. Thank you. So, does anyone want to add to that before we go on? Okay, let's go to the next question. How does John show that his disciples should not be jealous of Jesus' activity? Sister Prior Caitlin?
Well, he shows the illustration about the groom and the bridegrooms. And it said that, but the friend of the bridegroom, when he stands and hears him, has a great deal of joy on account of the voice of the bridegroom. So my joy has been made complete. So we see that John is a very encouraging friend, and he's teaching his disciples that they should be the same about Jesus.
Okay, thank you. A little more on that, Brother Cogley?
It made me think of modern day wedding situations. The best man usually is the best friend in the group. Not somebody that's going to be jealous of the groom because he's marrying that particular girl. It's somebody that's happy for him. And that's the point that John was trying to make. Is, look, I'm not the important one. Jesus is the important one. When I saw him, that made my heart glad.
Okay, good. And Sister Prior, Jolene.
In John 3:30, brought out that the one must keep on increasing, but I must keep on decreasing. So he was trying to help them to see that his purpose was to prepare the way for Jesus' ministry.
Very good, Brother Armijo. Next to you.
And when we talk about the increasing that was Jesus' part and the decreasing that was John's part, well, the followers, they had to get used to there was going to be a change. There was change in mind. And if you think about it, when we go through change, something different, sometimes we kind of, maybe we don't murmur, but we do think about
how does this make sense to us? But you know what? The way it was brought out here, and the bridegroom and the bride and all that, it explains it in a way to where we can take part in it and make it an easy change of things.
Okay, good. And Sister Trujillo in the back, please.
And as that illustration, the friend of the bridegroom, here he has accomplished his objective as being the friend of the bridegroom. What he was preparing the way for Christ Jesus' ministry. And so at this point, he was no longer the principal figure or the friend of the bridegroom. So he said, that's what he said. He must go on increasing and I will be decreasing, because he already met he accomplished what he was set out for from Jehovah.
Okay, good. And Brother Solano again up front.
His excitement to see Jesus come into the picture must have been awesome, because from infancy, actually before infancy, when he was in his mother's womb, he leaped at Mary's appearance. So he was excited from day one that this time should come. And so when Jesus comes into the picture and is presenting himself for baptism, this is the time that John realized, this is it. This is what my whole life led up to.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Brother Herrera.
Luke chapter 3, verse 15, it said that the Jews who were in anticipation of Jesus were wondering whether John was the Christ. And that's where he told them that he was not even able to untie the laces of that man. And so we see there that when John in the paragraph is saying, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent ahead of that one, that's John's way of telling them, don't be jealous for me, or don't be jealous for my disciples. We are all in anticipation of the Christ and what he will do.
Okay, thank you. Any more on that? The third question, why is John put into prison? Abigail Pryor, please.
Well, King Herod took Herodias, the wife of his half-brother Philip, and married her. So John publicly exposed his adulterous deed. So Herod had John put into prison.
Okay. Did that answer your question? Okay, sorry. Next time. Brother Cogley?
Here again, it's a case of John being sent ahead of Jesus, in a sense, because he was put in prison for exposing the misdeeds of those in power, just as Jesus was captured and tortured for exposing the misdeeds of the scribes and Pharisees.
Okay. And wasn't Herodias really guilty of being married to two men at once? So that made it awful in Jehovah's eyes, Sister Pryor.
Yeah, in those verses he said it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And then it said that Herodias was nursing a grudge against him and wanted to kill him, but she could not. So we can definitely see that they did not appreciate him pointing out their wrongs.
No, didn't appreciate the counsel at all. So we have some verses that we want to share tonight in tonight's lesson. And we'll begin with Brother Cogley reading Matthew 4 and verse 12.
Now when he had heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee.
And then we'll go on to Mark 6, 17 through 20.
For Herod himself had sent out and arrested John and had bound him in prison on account of Herodias, the wife of Philip, his brother, because he had married her. John had been saying to Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. So Herodias was nursing a grudge against him and wanted to kill him, but she could not, was in fear of John, knowing him to be a righteous and holy man, and he was keeping him safe. After hearing him, he was at a great loss as to what to do, yet he continued to hear him gladly.
Okay, and then Luke 3, 19 and 20.
But Herod, the district ruler, because of being reproved by John concerning Herodias, the wife of his brother, and concerning all the wicked deeds that Herod had done, added this also to all those deeds, he locked John up in prison.
Thank you. There we go. And then finally, the longer reading in John, John 3, 22 through 4, verse 3.
After this, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside, and there he spent some time with them and baptizing. But John, too, was baptizing in Anon near Salem, because there was a great quantity of water there, and people kept coming and were being baptized, for John had not yet been thrown into prison. Now the disciples of John had a dispute with a Jew concerning purification. So they came to John and said to him, "Rabbi, the man who was with you across the Jordan, about whom you bore witness, see, this one's baptizing, and we're going to him." In answer, John said, "A man cannot receive a single thing unless it has been given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I'm not the Christ, but I've been sent ahead of that one. Whoever has the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom, when he stands and hears him, has a great deal of joy on account of the voice of the bridegroom. So my joy has been made complete. That one must keep on increasing, but I must keep on decreasing. The one who comes from above is over all others. The one who is from the earth is from the earth and speaks of things of the earth. The one who comes from heaven is over all others. He bears witness to what he has seen and heard, but no man accepts his witness. Whoever has accepted his witness has put his seal to it that God is true. For the one whom God sent speaks the sayings of God, for he does not give the Spirit sparingly. The Father loves the Son, and has given all things into his hand. The one who exercises faith in the Son has everlasting life. The one who disobeys the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God remains upon him." When the Lord became aware that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did no baptizing, but the disciples did, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee.
Okay. What comments have you got for these scriptures, Sister Clark?
Luke 3, 19 and 20, it said that Herod had added this also to all those deeds. So he was keeping account of injury. Even though John was doing good things, he was keeping account of it. And this is something that we wouldn't want to do if our brothers and sisters possibly give us counsel, or if they do something wrong against us, we wouldn't want to keep the account of injury because we see the outcome. John got locked up in prison, but Herod was in the wrong.
Okay. Brother Cockney?
In the last verse we just read, John 4, verse 3, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. Well, right ahead of that, he heard through the grapevine or whatever that the Pharisees knew that he was making and baptizing more disciples than John. So they could see a threat building. And the better part of valor was to him not to hang around and wait for them to come after him, but to go to Galilee and just, you know, kind of defuse the situation a little. Same thing applies to us out of the ministry. If we see a situation developing, we don't wait for it to escalate. We quietly take our leave.
Thank you for bringing that up. Brother Martinez.
And along with it, the thought that when he left, after he left to Galilee, there was a lot of work yet to be done, so it was necessary for him to go do that work, and he took the other disciples with him.
Okay, good. And Sister Martinez, while you're there.
And John was very sure to reassure the disciples that it was good to listen to Jesus, that Jesus was the one who was sent from heaven there in 31. In 3:31, he says, "The one who comes from heaven The one who comes from above is over all others. The one from the earth is from the earth and speaks of things of the earth. The one who comes from heaven is over all others. So he repeatedly told them that Jesus was over John and they should accept him.
Thank you. Any Brother Stockman, please.
I'd like to talk a little bit about Luke 3, where John reproved Herod. I was thinking he had a lot of proof and information. That's why the man was, he was scared, he was nervous because of all his wicked deeds. So I was thinking, it wasn't just one thing that this man was doing, but when John publicly reproved him, he had everything according to Jehovah, Jehovah's will and truth to go against this man. That's why he had to shut him up and put him in prison.
Okay. Brother Pryor, please.
Even though we don't know a ton about John the Baptist, we do know he's a very spiritually minded individual. Kind of reminded me of a Watchtower lesson of becoming a spiritual person. We looked at some examples of old and really how their actions, how their expressions proved that they were a very spiritually minded person. And John did just that. That's why it wasn't hard for him to decrease as Jesus came on. He was humble. He had a very nice understanding of the scriptures. And it's a nice example for us.
Very good. Brother Herrera.
He proved to be a stabilizing factor to those that might have been concerned about what was going on and why things were happening the way that they were. And he just settled them down and was able to give them the information that they needed in order to keep them from going awry. Same similar thing with that other brother in the video that we watched. I just felt like it doesn't need to be an elder or ministerial servant to give counsel. It can be a mature brother or sister who just needs to be able to apply a stabilization to a situation in order to keep it from going getting out of hand. But we can each be that person regardless of whether we have privileges in the congregation.
Very good. Brother Romero, please.
I appreciated how John handled the situation when his followers were, what's that word? But anyway, he told him, he says, the man, they were jealous. That's the word I was looking for. It says, the rabbi, in verse 26, 3:26, John 3:26, says, the rabbi, the man who was with you across the Jordan, about whom you bore witness, see, this one is baptizing, and all are going to him. And I appreciated his answer. He says, in answer, John said, a man cannot receive a single thing unless it has been given him from heaven. So even with spiritual men, that's the same one, same thing.
Okay, very good. So, Brother Martinez, please.
Brother Herrera's comment struck me that a stabilizing factor in these kinds of things and the counseling we get from one another, as it might be, it stabilizes the whole congregation. If one person is counseled and takes that counsel well, it benefits the whole congregation, not just that one person.
Okay, good. And Sister Pryor.
And we know it was very important for them to realize or accept Jesus because in verse 33, it says, whoever has accepted his witness has put his seal to it that God is true. So this was confirmation that they were accepting Messiah's witness, and so that was acknowledging that God is true. So this was very important that they followed this.
Okay, good. So if one of the elders gives you counsel, does that mean he's ganging up on you? No. Sister Bobian?
It takes love for anybody to be able to give anybody counsel. And some people won't do it. So where is their love for their brother or their sister?
And do you think it's easy for the elders to come and talk to a publisher and
Absolutely not. Nobody wants to go counsel anybody, but as you know, the direction that they get from the psych class, that's what needs to be done. And we get counseled all the time, all the time. There's always something about what's going on. So this is coming from, you know, Jehovah through Jesus to us.
Okay. And Brother Martinez, please.
I thought about being counseled. If you get counseled, that brother cares about you. If you don't receive the counsel well, you don't care much about that brother. So look at it in that way.
Very good. And Sister Pryor.
And there's a scripture that says Jehovah disciplines those who he loves. So the brothers are an extension from that. So we should view it as Jehovah's love.
Good. Very good. And in fact, verse 34, Luke chapter 3, it says, "For the one whom God sent speaks the sayings of God." So when a brother does give counsel, he's not giving it in his own thoughts. He's speaking for Jehovah himself, and he uses the scriptures to back it up. Is there anything else before we turn it back over to Brother Pryor? If not, thank you for reading tonight. Thank you for your participation, audience. I appreciate that very much. Brother Pryor, please.